Hi guys, Michigan Snow Pony Renee, and I just thought I'd do a garden update. What you're looking at are my cucumbers. Yes, they did sprout. I actually had five of them, but a couple of them were really close together, so I pulled them out. So I wound up with three, and these are the Armenian cucumbers I've never grown, and from the old seed. You'll see that in the previous video. So I'm really tickled pink. We'll see if we like them. Tomatoes are doing well. I'll compare these tomatoes to the ones in the greenhouse. You'll be amazed because they were all started at the same time, but the difference in plant size is phenomenal. And I see my little pig tomatoes have already started to blossom. They're planted on the end. I got my hills for my melons in. My watermelon is not doing too great. I had to go buy melon plants. I forgot to start them. So we'll see what happens. This isn't the kind of watermelon I would grow. I usually grow sugar babies. This is just plain old run-of-the-mill big melons, but or moon and stars. I like that too. But we'll see if they produce. They produce. If they don't, they don't. And over here is the honeydews, the green melons, and they've already got some blossoms. So it'll feed. And I think I've got two hills of what I call muskmelon, but everybody else calls cantaloupe, the orange ones, and they're doing pretty well. So, there's the potatoes. I've already hilled them once. And then my purple potatoes that I got some clearance boxes. They're coming up. And one right there. And right there. And right there. So, we'll be able to try those this year. Here's the row of kale. Yeah, I know. I should thin it. You know how I am about thinning things. And then the Swiss chard, I'm never sure how to say that. There that row is. And what's next here? Oh, my cilantro, which I've never grown. And that's coming up pretty nicely. So I'm excited about that. I use that quite a bit. I love cilantro. Yeah, I know, I should thin it. Quit yelling at me. here's the basil. And that's, I left in little clumps. I did thin the basil, I did. Because that was really thick. So, there's a weed I gotta get. I can't stand it. There we go. So I'm really happy about that. And this row, right, this little section right here, I planted in some strange bean seeds I had. They're old. If they come up, great. If not, cowpeas. They were cowpeas, that's what they were. Because I don't think I had enough seed to continue on the row with my romaine lettuce. And that seed is all coming up really nicely, too. I had one little mishap with the plants that I started. Something came in here and ate them all down. I think it was a bird. It left me one plant. So all these plants should be this size. But in doing so, it ate it right down the nubs. But you'll see they're all coming back. So I was planning on just pulling them out when they got to be about this size. And now I'm gonna just take the leaves as they get big, like I should pick some off this plant, and let them grow back. I didn't know you could do that with romaine, because I've always purchased it as one big head in the store. So, but I'll just take leaves now that I know it comes back. So thank you, bird. I've got the garden fence for rabbits, so I know it wasn't a rabbit. Onions are up. Believe it or not, I did weed 2 days ago. these are the wax beans, followed by the green onions, which never showed, so I just replanted them the other day. They shouldn't be up yet, but hopefully I'll see some shortly. These are black turtle beans that I got from Baker's Creek. Beans this year are not my forte because these came up very spotty. I have a half row here and a half row over there, and both rows are just hit or miss. I mean, there'll be a section where they came up really nicely, and then big gaps. Same with my green beans. Now, the green beans I went through and planted in all the gaps, but the green beans were really spotty, and all my bean seeds this year were fresh, were new. So I'm not sure what's going on with the bean seeds. My New Zealand spinach is coming up. I had to replant that with new seed. But it's coming up. I think I accidentally pulled some towards the front of the when I was weeding. Oops. But I'll have enough. Beets are up. Now the beets I should thin because they're round instead of long and skinny like a carrot. So yeah, those don't do so well crowded in. So I will probably have to get out here and thin the beetroot. Carrots. You know I don't thin the carrots. They're coming up like gangbusters. Both rows. You kind of see the other row there. So I'm really happy about that. We love carrots. And the brassicas. They're all doing really well. We've had lots and lots of rain. You know, before the garden, rain is a curse. And after the garden, it's a blessing. After you get the garden in anyway. So I can almost tell the cabbages now. They're more flat, the plants are. And I'm going to have to mix up some BT. If you don't know what that is, I'll put a link somewhere. It's a stuff you mix up and you spray your leaves to keep the cabbage worms off. It's a virus. It's organic. It's all natural. And you spray the leaves, and then the little caterpillars munch on them, turn black, and die. It's really satisfying to see their little black bodies on the leaves. And it does a really good job. The only thing is, you have to keep spraying after a rain. I mean, keep up with it. I find if you can just spray the underside of the leaves, it lasts longer. Otherwise, if you're spraying the top, you got to do it after every rain. But the brassicas are doing well. The Yukon Gold potatoes, I've hilled those already once. And I don't think you need to hill Yukon Gold, but I do it anyway because I've always done it. And then my little freebie potatoes are coming up. These are the Pontiac Reds. I have this row, and I have two little rows on the other side, up at the front of the garden on either side of the fence. The corn, popcorn, is doing pretty good. I've been hoeing between the rows. You can't really tell. It looks weedy, but the only thing that's not, and I have to remember this next year, well, corn won't be here, but I have to stay off this fence. I planted that fourth row way too close. It gets too much shade. You can really see the difference between that row and the other three. So I have to start my rows way out here and give myself about 3 feet instead of a foot off the fence. But I'm excited. I'm hoping we're going to have some popcorn this year. Saved me lots of money with my daughter. So everything's doing well. The squashes in the boxes. I think I'm going to lose. Yeah, I did. I lost a spaghetti squash plant, but I have another one that's growing in the house. So, but I still have two back here. We'll see. Or maybe I'll have one. This one doesn't look too great either. The zucchini's doing fine. I have an empty box. I got to figure out what to put in it. I'm going to have to bring the kitty litter sifter back here and try to get some stones out. But then I'll decide what I'm going to put there. These are the squashes that didn't have tags. So they're acorn or butternut. I don't know what. Or maybe they're a combination. They're all doing well. These are from the store. These are the acorn squash and, of course, the butternut. And I'll just have to keep my eye out for the dreaded squash bugs. So there you go. Everything's doing pretty darn good. So far, so good. Really, I've got to weed my boxes from the side. Seriously? Oh my gosh. It's stuck in there. Well, I guess that's the best I can do. I didn't think the gaps in these boxes were that wide, but boy, nature finds a way, doesn't she? Aha! I planted these bushes years ago when we were trying to get a little orchard going back here, and they survived. The orchard didn't, and I've forgotten what they were. And this year they produced fruit. Not much, but they produced fruit. They're Nanking cherries. I thought that's what they were, but I wasn't 100% sure. Now I am. So they look pretty healthy. They just haven't ever produced fruit until this year. And they must be six, seven years old now. But now I know what they are. And they're really, they don't have a lot of berries, but these are pretty good size for little Nanking cherries. Usually they're smaller. No, the ones up by the house are anyway. Groovy. For my new subs, I just thought I'd show you how I water the garden back here when it isn't raining. And we do it with this little well point that we put down, probably 8 years ago. I do have a video on it if you want to know how. It's a little, I think it's a 1.5 or 2 inch well. And we hook it up to a gas powered pump, which is covered in weeds, I know. And very easy to start. And then what I have been doing is filling these tubs up with water and then going around with my little watering can and doing the plants individually or the rows individually. Later in the year, we might have to put a sprinkler with the pump running on the corn. We usually get a dry spell, and the corn is really thirsty, so we might have to do that. But for now, this is how I do it. I just run it, fill up the tubs. When they're filled, I turn it off, go water, and I usually, three times of these tubs filled, will get the whole garden, because I'm doing the plants almost individually, or the rows. So that's how we water back here, because we're quite a ways from the house. And like I say, if you're interested in how to put down a well point, this is a shallow well. I'll put a link to the video, maybe right up above here, and you can see how we did that. You do need a high water table. These little pumps won't pull water up from, well, a hand pump won't pull it long, your static water level won't pull it further down than 23 feet. I'm not sure about these little pumps, these little gas-powered pumps, if they'll go deeper. But they're not that big. I don't know how many horsepower it is, but maybe half a horsepower. I don't know. But you do need a high water table if you're going to drill your own well like this. We used to have the old-fashioned hand pump on it, but this is way faster, less work-intensive. So. And if we do want to run a sprinkler later in the year, we just fill it up, run the sprinkler until it runs out of gas, and can leave it going. Not the most effective water system, but you work with what you have. Someone mentioned my empty pig pens on my last garden video. See, that garden's right over there, neighbor's house. Yeah, they're empty. I'm trying to decide what to do about pigs. I still want to raise our own pork, but I'm not going to do breeding anymore. I'm not good at it. But I'm trying to decide when to raise pork. Right now, the piglets are so expensive. The fair kids have their pigs by now, and so that rush is over. But I'm still not seeing the price come down, because summer is usually the easy time, or the cheap time, to feed pigs. You know, you feed them grass clipping, you feed them all kinds of stuff. And I've noticed in the fall is when you find the $30, $40, maybe $50 piglets. Right now they're $100, $150. Once in a while I'll see them for $70 or $80. And my freezer is pretty full right now. So really, I don't think I'll have room in the fall to put more pork in there. So I'm thinking I might get fall piglets and raise them up in the barn with those pig pens that we made in the barn for that purpose. And Tim wanted to tear this all down, and I said, no, don't do it just yet, because maybe I'll get them midsummer. I don't know. We're going to go on vacation in a couple weeks to the Upper Peninsula. And let me know if you want to see video from that. Upper Peninsula is beautiful, absolutely beautiful part of Michigan. We're going to hit all the landmarks up there. So if you want to see video on our vacation, let me know. Otherwise, I won't bother. But as to what to do with these pig pens, I'm still debating. Because if I get pigs late summer, I'll pop them back here. And then bring them up to the barn, which might be a hassle. See, I'm in a quandary. The only pig breed I would ever consider going back to raising would be purebred Cooney Coonies. I did not have purebreds. And the more I look at the purebreds that are online, the more I know mine weren't. They were delicious. They were good little homestead pigs, but they weren't purebred Cooney Coonies. I just like the small size pig. So much easier. And my pens are actually designed with a smaller pig in mind. That's why the Mangalitsas were delicious pork. Really liked the female, the sow. She was good mama. But just too big. That boar, oh my gosh, he made me nervous. Huge, huge boar. The Cooney Coonies too, you do not have, well, the ones I had, my little half-breeds, you did not have to fix the males. You could just raise them up. You didn't have to castrate them. And we raised, even our boar, when I quit, he was 3 years old, and his meat was fine. There was no boar taint, what they call boar taint, to it. And I love that about them. They're just an easy, easy homestead pig. But they're very pricey, the purebreds. So, and I don't know if I want to do that again. I just don't know. I think my best bet is just to grab a piglet or two, raise it for 5-6 months, and put it in the freezer. You know, like normal people do. Normal homesteaders. Anyway, yes, my pig pens are empty and I'm still deciding how I want to proceed with homegrown pork. We know we want that. I just can't quite decide how to go about it in the future. So, and in the meantime, I'm not letting Tim take these down just yet. Okay, I just want to show you the difference a greenhouse makes. These tomato plants were all started with the ones in the garden. But of course they got put out in the greenhouse before the ones in the garden got planted. But the growth on them is just phenomenal. These are the Brandywines. We got some blossoms. The Rutgers. The little pig tomatoes. And these are the peppers. I cannot grow peppers outside. I've tried and tried and tried. And just never have success. The plants grow, no peppers, or the plants just stay stunted. So I did have to buy these at the farm store because I can't seem to get them started either. But they're doing really well. In fact, this one has a little pepper on it already. And lots of blossoms coming. I love growing peppers out here in the greenhouse. It's so easy. So the other thing that loves the greenhouse, I've discovered, are the ground cherries. These were all started at the same time, put out here at the same time, but the discrepancy between the plants, I mean, here's this little one, this great big one in the back. They already have blossoms on them. So, looking forward to those. And then down here, for some reason, this box, the tomatoes love. Last year I had the pig tomatoes in it, they got huge. This year I have the yellow jubilees, and they are almost to the top with blossoms. So I don't know, there must be something in this box that tomatoes really like. But, so isn't that amazing though? I look at these compared to the ones in the garden, I just can't believe they were all started at the same time. Unbelievable. So, and they'll get so heavy that I will end up having to tie these to the top of the greenhouse. But, and it'll get 100 degrees in here. How the plants like it, I don't know, but they love it. These three especially, peppers, tomatoes, and ground cherries. And I think the ground cherries, they're in the tomato family, I'm pretty sure. So, I'm not surprised they like it too. So I just thought I'd show you that, because I find it fascinating how different conditions, you know, determine the size of the plants. And how fast they grow. So there's the greenhouse. I'm keeping my eye on these. These are the wild raspberries in the front yard that I always make jam out of. The black raspberries. And the bushes are loaded again this year, so I can't wait. And the mulberries are just starting to come on and be ripe. I love mulberries. The nice thing about mulberry trees is they fruit for a very long period of time. The bad thing about them is the birds love them, and everything in your property will be splattered with purple bird poop. It's the truth. I tell it like it is. But if you can steal them away from the birds, they're absolutely delicious.